Jewish people, they refer to God as Hashem. What does that mean? The name. Why is that important? Because the name covers your sins.
Welcome to Cross the Bridge with David McGee. Let's join Pastor David now as he continues his verse-by-verse teaching of God's Word.
What makes a rainbow so beautiful? That it's different. So many colors. I mean, if you saw a rainbow and it was all one color, that'd be a little weird, wouldn't it? No, but there's different colors. That's what makes it so beautiful. When you look out at the body of Christ, different colors, different people, different backgrounds, different careers, different gifts, different personalities, different characteristics. So don't come in here thinking, well, I got to be like this. Any church where they say, well, you got to, this is what a Christian looks like. How do you know what a Christian looks like? Well, they got to wear their hair like this and no earrings and no tattoos and no this and no that. Where do you get that? You know what that's basically being communicated, and this is weird? You need to look like me because me's good. So God gives gifts. We have the fivefold ministry the Bible talks about. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 says, and he himself, he himself gave what? To the church, these fivefold ministry. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So you got the fivefold ministry. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. Potentially, somebody could walk occasionally in all five of those. I think I probably occasionally walk in maybe three, pastor, teacher, evangelist, maybe prophet sometime. I talked to a man that pastored me for years. I'm spending more and more time with him. Pastored me years ago. Great man. A lot of wisdom. He's in his 80s now. And just, he came in, we spent hours together praying, time with staff, and the guy is what you would term an apostle. Now, I know we get weird about that word, but what that means is God has gifted him to encourage other shepherds. And probably 15 churches have come out of that one church. Most actually by accident, but that's another discussion. I can relate. And then Ephesians 4 talks about the fivefold ministry. Romans chapter 12 lists another list of giftings. Romans 12, 6 says, in his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. See, we do different things. So the expectation that we're all the same is simply not biblical. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you're a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it is giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. So there's a whole list there in that chapter, Romans 12, of teaching and encouraging. You see, giving. I need to encourage people, not beat them up financially, but I need to encourage people in the ministry of giving. I need to do that. Verse 20 says, but now indeed there are many members, yet one body. So again, there's this diversity. So the Bible's talking about there's a diversity. How do we get locked into we all got to look like this? We all got to act like this. We all got to talk like this. All of us do that. Pastors do that a lot. I love watching other pastors teach. I do. I do it a lot. Yeah, I get ideas and I just watch them, mannerisms and stuff. But praise God, I've gotten more mature in ministry, and I don't, when you're first starting out in ministry, whoever you're watching, you begin to, take on their mannerisms and stuff, and oh, I need to do it like this, But see, God wants us all to be different. because there's a beauty in that. There really is. And what's sad is in some places, in some spiritual communities, if somebody comes in and they feel a little different, they actually are made to feel like they don't belong. Let me tell you something. If you're unique, and everybody in here is, we need you. We need your uniqueness. Because at some point, somebody else is going to walk through that door that you will click with. Maybe your past, your history, maybe your education, maybe what you do for a living. And because of your uniqueness, how you, and maybe the enemy has come and said, well, you don't really belong here. You're not whatever. No, your uniqueness is why you belong here. Because we're all unique. And if we were all the same, it would be redundant, or one of us wouldn't be necessary. But the Bible talks about this uniqueness. And because of that, it doesn't matter what somebody does. Their past, their background, how they help. Every person's important. Every person. Life lesson here is each person in this church is important. Each person in this church is important. You are important. The person sitting beside you is important. The person sitting behind you is important. The person sitting in front of you is important. Now, we all need balancing. The Bible gives us balance. Some of you already think you're very, very important. And you need to realize the people around you are important. Some may not realize how important you are. And you need to be encouraged of how valuable you are to the kingdom of God and to this body. That's the body of Christ. And it's beautiful the way it works. Amen? I've talked about it before, but, you know, the attend, give, serve, small group. You should do those four things. They're simple. Everybody can understand them. Attend, give, serve, be in a small group. Now, the cool thing is you've already knocked out 25% of that list. Excellent. Excellent. If you go by the box on the way out, you're halfway there. You know what I mean? So sign up to serve the small group. I mean, this is not rocket science. And yet, when you do these things, what happens? It's a little bit more commitment each time. And I know people say, well, I'm just not sure I have the time. No, maybe you're afraid of the commitment. But God will bless that commitment. Because do you understand your body? Do you understand your body is committed to itself? In other words, your hand, if you're taking notes, you might want to jot this down. Your hand is connected to your arm. So there's a commitment there. There's a commitment. Your nose is committed to your face. I know this is simple, but seriously, I mean, sometimes I may go somewhere that smells bad and my nose is like, I don't want to be here. But my nose doesn't like jump down off my face and run off. Come back here. And my stomach, I may go, you know, if there's like a merry-go-round, my stomach don't want to go on the merry-go-round. You know, but my stomach doesn't say, well, you know, I'm going to leave while you go on the merry-go-round. Now, after the merry-go-round, never mind. But but it doesn't, you don't have, well, I'm not, you know what, I'm out of here. I'm part of the body, but I'm going to leave. You can come pick me up after. No, it's committed. You go places together. You go through storms. You go through trials together. Verse 21 says, and the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. I've heard people say, I only need God. You're wrong. We need each other. The Bible points that out. This verse points that out. It says we can't, one member can't say another, we don't need you. If the eye said to the hand, we don't need you, and the hand ran off, how would you feed yourself? What if your brain got in a mutiny, and or your hand got in a mutiny? What if your hand said, I'm tired of the brain running everything. We do everything the brain wants to do. The brain says, do this, and we do that. The brain says, do that, and we do. I'm sick of that. And then next time you go to eat, your hand says, you know what? I think now's the time. And you pick up a fork. And your brain's going, fork, hand, take the food to your mouth. But the hand says, nope, I am taking the brain out, and your fork lands right in the middle of your forehead. Why? Because your hand's in rebellion. The body doesn't function well like that. We need each other. That's the next life lesson here, is we need God and we need each other. We need God and we need each other. That's scary, I understand. To think that we need each other. Why do we need each other? Because somebody beside you has gifts you don't have, and one day you're going to need those gifts. And I know we like to think that we're all independent, but you're not. You probably go to a grocery store to buy your food that somebody else grew. You buy meat there that somebody else raised and slaughtered. You live in a house that somebody else built. You drive a car that somebody else built. We need each other. And there's nothing wrong with that. God set it up like that. And we need to become more like Jesus in our relationships with one another. And to realize that we need to start trying to treat each other like Jesus treats us.
David McGee will be right back with more teaching from the Word of God.
Hi, friend. I want to thank you for watching Cross the Bridge with Dave McGee. I'm Pastor David, and I want to invite you to come visit us at the bridge in Kernersville. You might not realize it, but the telecast is actually recorded right there in Kernersville at the church. So I want to encourage you to come to Kernersville, only minutes from Greensboro, Winston-Salem, High Point, and the surrounding areas. And I personally invite you to come, and I look forward to seeing you. This could be what you're looking for.
Welcome back as Pastor David continues on Cross the Bridge.
What if we treated each other the way that Jesus treats us? What if Jesus treated us like we treat each other? What if you go to pray tonight or tomorrow and you say, God, Jesus, I am so sorry. Lord, I messed up. I shouldn't have said that, and I shouldn't have done that. Please forgive me, Jesus. And Jesus says, oh, yes, I forgive you. Okay, thank you, God, for forgiving. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me. I'm going to go on my way now. Okay, my son, go on your way. God bless you. You're forgiven. You walk away, and Jesus says, I can't wait to get on Facebook. You wouldn't believe what he did. Amen or on me? See, we got to be committed. It's like this chair. I'm not really committed to this chair. I walk around it. Some of you, if you come here, you keep expecting me to sit on it. I move around a lot. But now, check it out. I'm kind of committed now, right? Why? Because I'm leaning on it. It's the beginning of a commitment. But then I can get up. But check this out. This brings back bad memories. Did I say that out loud? Now I'm committed. So I can't go anywhere. I'm here. Chair, I don't like you anymore. There's a commitment here. That chair's with me. Now, that chair may be going, don't quit moving, stop. But it's with me. Wow, there's a commitment there. Now, what's cool is if I did this, guess what? Anytime I wanted somewhere to sit. Now, of course, at some point, somebody at the store is going to say, what in the world are you doing? It's okay. It's an example. So there's a commitment here. There's a connection. And it's more than just a temporary connection. Amen? It's not that risky. I have a police officer in the front row, man. But let me ask you a question. Which of you are willing to have a commitment with me? That wherever you go, I go. When you hit a trial, friend, I'm there. That's commitment. That's commitment. What if we're playing the what if game? What if the church treated families like sometimes the families treat the church? Would it work? I would call a family and go, hey, you know, we really like you guys, but you know, we've been discussing it, and you know, there's another family, and we've been talking about it, and to be honest, we like their kids a little better, so we're going to go with the other family. And, or, you know, somebody calls and says, hey, you know what, we're just called to tell you, you know, we heard this rumor, and we're not even going to ask you whether it's true or not, or if it's actually happened, but we're going to pick the other family, we're going to have them come to our church, we're going to ask you not to. Do you realize people do that? How would you imagine that that makes a leader, pastor, deacon, elder feel? Especially when that leader knows that God brought him. Is that the kind of commitment you want from leadership here? What would the world look like if you and I and you and the people around you were actually better friends, more committed? Do you understand that's something that you need? I think most of us understand how painful loneliness is. God has a solution for loneliness. A relationship with Him, and part of His solution is called the church. The body of Christ. And I wonder how many murders and suicides and hunger and poverty could be avoided if we were the kind of friends that God wants us to be with each other. There's a story in the Bible about Naomi. She has two sons. The two sons marry these two daughters, and later on, the two sons die, and she turns to the two daughters-in-laws and said, you know what, I'm too old to have any more kids. Just go and try to find somebody else to marry. And Orpah goes off and does that. But listen to what Ruth says. Ruth, chapter 1, verse 16. But Ruth said, entreat me not to leave you. Don't ask me to leave you or to turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you lodge or live, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God my God. And where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. And the Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts you and me. That's commitment. That's friendship. That's the kind of commitment that we as a body of Christ are supposed to have. Oh, but what happens if one of us perceives a flaw in the other? Well, let me go ahead and tell you, as senior pastor, I know you got problems. I know you got issues. The assisting pastors, the elders, know you got problems and issues. It's very, you know, when somebody sits down and says, oh man, I'm dealing with this, you know what? We're very rarely shocked. And a lot of times it's stuff that either we've done in the past or somebody we know has been involved with. We're not going to look at you and go, wow, man, I didn't know you had problems. Maybe you should go to church somewhere else. Now, when you become aware of a flaw or you perceive there's a flaw in somebody, how you handle them tells a lot about your character. The Bible says love covers a multitude of sins. I'm going to tell you as a pastor that I'm committed to the people here. Not until I find out they messed up. The story of Noah's sons, and it's very interesting. Noah, of course, there was the flood. He built the boat. The flood came, went back. Noah planted a vineyard, and it's after the flood, and he drank of the fruit of the vineyard, drank too much, got drunk, and was naked in his tent. And Ham went into his dad's tent, saw his dad was in there, had been drinking and was naked, went out and told his two other brothers. Man, dad got drunk. He's in there. Man, this is messed up. Ham revealed what Noah did wrong. Shem and Japheth, the other two sons, you know what they did? They got a blanket. They walked backwards. And they covered their father up. What's interesting is Ham, for the rest of his life, was cursed for uncovering the sins of his father. Japheth and Shem were blessed because they respected their father. As a matter of fact, here's something that's interesting. What does Shem mean? In the Hebrew, it means name. As a matter of fact, a lot of people, Jewish people, they refer to God as Hashem. What does that mean? The name. Why is that important? Because the name covers your sins. When you go to Jesus and ask him to forgive you, what does he do? He forgives you. Does he post it on Facebook? No. I'm sure he could. Now here's your moment to ask for God's forgiveness. Or maybe you've been wounded and you've been carrying that around. Today you can be healed. You just put that down and forgive the person. I'm going to lead you in a prayer asking God to forgive you. Whether you're up front or still seated or watching in Greensboro or listening on the radio or watching through television or the live stream, I want you to pray out loud with me right now. Dear Jesus, I believe you died for me so that I could be forgiven. And I believe you were raised from the dead so I could have a new life. And God, I've done wrong things. And I've not been a good friend. And I ask you to forgive me of all those things. To give me your power to follow you. And to be a friend to others. In Jesus' name.
If you've prayed this prayer with Pastor David, he would love to hear from you and help you get off to a good start as a follower of Christ. We'd love to bless you with a new believer's kit, absolutely free. So please call us now or write to let us know. You've just made the greatest decision you'll ever make.
Congratulations to those people who just asked God to forgive them. Awesome decision. You know, I want to encourage you, as you hear these teachings, to apply them to your life. I've dedicated myself to help and share the truths of the Bible, to help you deal with life, and to discover the abundant life that Jesus talks about and offers to each and every one of you.
I also want to invite you to get a free email devotional that I send out every day. Just go to crossthebridge.com, put in your email, and I'll send you an email every day to encourage you. Hey friend, I'd love for you to come join us here Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. You know, after the service, we have a time that as you set aside to meet the folks who come for the first time, and I'd love to get to meet you. So I personally invite you to attend the service in that time after. And also, you can watch live stream Thursdays at 7 or Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. Also, check out the website at crossthebridge.com. Do you know and love people that don't know Jesus as their Savior? You know, I want to join with you in praying for these people. And I've got hundreds of people that are committed to praying for them as well, for them to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus. Go to crossthebridge.com, put in their first names, and I'll be praying for them, and these hundreds of folks will be praying for those people to come to know Jesus. Take the time to do this. It's really important. Now, our offer this month is Cross the Bridge to Life, Discover Your Adventure. It's my new book, and I'd love for you to have it so much that for an offering of any amount, we'll send you this book. Our operators are standing by right now. Give them a call. And for an offering, just do the best you can. We'll send you the book out. It's changing lives, and I know that it'll change yours. I want to thank the partners who've joined with us and standing with us and supporting this ministry. And you know what? You can help us make a difference, either through a one-time gift or becoming a friend of Cross the Bridge with monthly support. Let me pray. God, thank you for this day. This is the day that you've made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And God, I thank you for each person that's joined us today, watched the program, and God, may they begin to apply the truths that you're speaking to them. And Lord, may they find that blessed life that you offer. So Lord, thank you for our friends who support us. Thank you for the people who just viewed. We thank you for the program itself. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll see you next week as we cross the bridge.
Now you can help Cross the Bridge Ministries take David's book to those who need to hear a message of forgiveness and hope.
I see the love from Christians.
For every $10 you give to Cross the Bridge Ministries, an inmate will receive a copy of Cross the Bridge to Life, Discover Your Adventure, as well as a copy of God's Word.
I'm just a totally different person.
Imagine your gift of $50 reaching 5 prisoners with the gospel, or your gift of $1,000 equipping 100 inmates with the tools to live abundantly in Christ.
I actually got peace in my life.
To partner with David McGee in reaching inmates, go online to crossthebridge.com and click on the Cross the Bridge to Hope button. Or call us today at 877-458-5508. That's 877-458-5508. Our representatives are standing by. Caring for those in prison is close to our Lord's heart. Won't you join us to share God's message of forgiveness with those the world has forgotten? Call today. Your support will help inmates cross the bridge to hope. The preceding program has been brought to you by the friends and partners of Cross the Bridge Ministries.